What is Ultrain Sports?
Ultrain Sports is a platform that this summer you could go on live and join on live streams with pro players who play in the EPL, La Liga, and just giving people in America and across the world access to pro players that they wouldn't regularly have. I look at a franchise so differently than I did when I wasn't in this space. Sports is for two things, entertainment and to make money. In America, we understand it's marketing and branding. Mm. And when you look at the Dallas Cowboys, they probably have 5% of Barcelona's fans and they make more money than Barcelona.
Wow.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. You are now tuned in to the EPB podcast. It's your boy Matt Marshall as usual, and I'm joined by a very special guest, Mr. Darrius Marcellin, entrepreneur.
Among other things, he has this great company, Ultrain Sports.
Ultrain Sports,
and we're gonna get into it a little bit, but welcome. I appreciate you coming in.
I love the fit you're wearing.
I'm
man.
Saying, yeah.
You're having season three. So season three dropped, so it looks good in you.
Yeah.
The earth colors.
And when you're ready to have some models come up. And,
yeah, you know, I'll bring you up. The tall guys.
It brings out the colors in my eyes.
Yeah. No, it looks fresh.
Yeah. So, yeah, I first want to, it's so funny. We run in similar circles. We have, like, a lot of 1 degree separated friends.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about that. But I've seen Ultrain kind of through social media, through other things, and in a microcosm, but I have kind of no idea what it is.
Yeah.
So I want to start off with what that is, just like a little, you know, elevator pitch, and then we kind of maybe go back a little bit how you built it. But what is Ultrain Sports?
Ultrain Sports is a platform that this summer you could go on live and join on live streams with pro players who play in the EPL, La Liga, the MLS, NWSL, all the top leagues. You could jump on a live stream and these players will be going through presentations about just going over film of why they made a shot, what was going through their head at the World Cup, what they eat before games, and just giving people in America and across the world access to pro players that they wouldn't regularly have.
Yeah, I mean, so they can just literally go on an app and be like, man, I'll give an example of myself growing up and just watching, I mean, I'm talking about before soccer games. I would go on YouTube and watch Ronaldo highlights, Thierry Henry highlights or whatever. Like, this is kind of like deeper, in-depth. You have a personal connection to these players and you're like seeing what they're doing on a daily basis or...
Yeah. So whoever we have scheduled live, like they jump on like Friday, let's just see, for example, just throw names out there. Bruno Fernandez is going to be on live. Bruno's going to talk about like, what he was going through in his mind when he took this PK or like what he does before games, what's his ritual, you know? You have the opportunity to jump on that live stream and just soak up all that access. And as fans, it's cool. And then as players, it's like you get to learn too. So
And I was going to say, like, what's in it for the players? They just get to kind of push out more of what they're doing on a
regular basis. I guess how the company started kind of circles back to what's in it for the players. You know, like, first things first is majority of people who, when we launched, you know, we're in our network of friends, you know, so our partners and our team come from players to my business partner and I, you know, running one of the biggest companies in New York where we did events. And, you know, a lot of these players were friends and clients of ours that we were able to look out for on their times in America.
Yeah.
I'm also players in the Premier League, in German League and La Liga. And full circle, we launched in this company and, you know, them, you know, kind of like plugging us back and saying like, this is our time to do this.
Yeah.
It's been like a great journey. Working with athletes is so difficult, just so you know. I can imagine us being an agent, like tracking our athletes, doing emails, like, but full circle, like they just have a abundance of knowledge and wealth and just getting, you know, that knowledge from a pro player. Yes, your coach will give you great advice, and yes, you know, like your parents could give you good advice and whoever, but just seeing it and just being there on your phone where you're going to spend the majority of your time.
Yeah.
Like, and seeing content that isn't on YouTube and isn't on TikTok on an IG,
yeah,
I think is where we're stepping into and offering everyone here.
Yo, wait, so there's a lot to unpack in just that description. Yeah. Take me back a little bit, because you said you were, how this started was you were working for a company in New York.
Yeah.
And you had connections to players. So this was like a marketing company, or is this, what were you doing?
Yeah, so we owned a company. Okay. When we were in college, we started this, like,
big entrepreneurial energy. Listen up.
Yeah, well, we were juniors in college. My partner Troy and I, you know, we were in New York, and, you know, we were just like those nightclub promoters hustling the streets in Soho on our phones, just like, you know, let's, you know, just connecting with people. We would, like, work all these nightclubs, and then eventually we built our network. And that's when we discovered the power of your network.
Yeah.
We built our network so big that nightclubs were like, oh, like, you know, like, why don't you guys, like, we'll hire you guys directly to like, run our stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, while we were juniors in college, we had, like, you know, like, 40, 50 people working for us. We had a WeWork office, and we were, you know, we were definitely like running the packing district at one point in time.
Wow.
I'm working with a lot of venues, and we just built a brand of treating people right and keeping people in our network. You know, like, we were always honest, treat people right. And then it just kind of went full circle to working with a lot of the players. And then the players would be like in the locker room, you know, they might be in a Liverpool locker room, like, yo, if you ever go to New York, like, these guys, Darrius and Troy, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how we built our reputation and did that for over a decade, you know?
That's what's crazy, that you were like, that's a completely different world. Plus nightlife. Yeah. You know, entertainment in New York, you know, one of the capitals of the world.
Yeah. Well, I played. I would say football was. I played soccer my entire life.
Yeah.
I grew up in Trinidad, you know, played on the youth team. And then I was like, all right, moved to America as a teenager. And, you know, I played D1 at St. Francis. And then I was just like thinking of going on to play after. And at the time, like, the money wasn't that big. It was like 2010-ish, like, draft and everything. Like, players were making like 19K a year, and they were like top in the draft. And I was like, that just doesn't fit right for me.
Yeah.
And like, kind of knew my value.
Yeah.
So I was like, all right, well, we just take the company and we just went with it. You know, we didn't turn back. And it was a blessing, because the lessons that we learned from just being in the streets of New York, we just got like a PhD in understanding people, communicating, building your network.
Yeah.
And that was one thing I definitely like cherish. You know, we didn't have the traditional job, and we didn't have the traditional fallback, which, you know, sometimes is very scary not having that.
Yeah.
But what we did get was just like this knowledge. So like, full circle into 2023, and we started this company in 2020, but in 2023, when now we're launching this program, it's like, oh, like, our network allowed us to launch this beta product into the market. And, you know, what we're going to do next is just going to be like, just we're going to provide more value for kids, fans, and coaches.
Yeah. And I mean, and like, from a business perspective, probably brands, and especially in America,
right,
World Cup's coming, all of that stuff. So, I mean, this is like a full circle.
Yeah.
You know, you should, if you're not interested or you're not invested, you should at this point, right?
Right.
Yeah. Talk about you say the company, I mean, it seems like the idea was formed probably from, you know, decades ago, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and how that came, and then what you've been doing in the last 3 years of it. Like, what was the transition to finally go from like, this would be cool, to like, this is what it is. This is cool. You know?
Yeah. No, crazy enough, when people say when Ultrain started, they, you know, like, the company was incorporated 3 years ago, but this whole thing was over like 12, I would say like 14 years in the works, you know? That's like being on, learning these business skills, developing a network, and just being so tapped in to every country, city in the world.
Yeah.
It afforded you the ability to create a product that would be very difficult to create if you didn't have the connections, and if you didn't have the trust of people too. because a lot of people wouldn't want to associate their brand with somebody they didn't trust.
Yeah.
Even if you came with like 10K and I was like, hey, like, you know, jump on my podcast, you know, the first question would be like, well, what's the podcast? Well, what are they talking about?
Right.
I don't know if I have time, right? So I think this company and would have never been a thing if I didn't have that experience before. And it's just like a walking lesson in life, no matter what you're doing, like whatever you're doing right now. And even sometimes it might be difficult because I have had a difficult time through like doing my events company. It might be difficult, but it's definitely setting you up for when that occasion comes. Like you're going to have the opportunity to do something that is like your calling or your personal legend.
Yeah. And it's tough. I mean, shoot, that's like, this is within the whole ethos of Eat, Pray, Ball, which is like finding yourself, right? And like me, you know, and it's fluid, right? In life, like you're constantly finding yourself in different things.
Yeah.
Me, it's easier to attach myself to the game to find different things, you know, within the realm that I want to
play. Right, right.
I'm
right.
A filmmaker, but I'm making content about soccer most often. You know what I mean? Things like that. These relationships that you've built and these connections that you've made, can you talk about like how long that takes? Who are you talking to? Yeah. How do people who normally have people, you know, always grabbing for something from them, you know, build such trust in you? Like, what is that about?
Yeah, I think it comes down to bringing value to people. It's very rare you'll be given a shot. I'd say like a 5% shot if you couldn't bring value to somebody, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
If somebody did something for you and you couldn't bring value, it's so rare.
Yeah.
So I think wherever you go, and even me coming to LA, I always look for like how I could bring value to people in a scope. Like how could we connect some dots to make something work, right?
Yeah.
And I'm always connecting dots and I'm always plugging people. I'm always making moves. Like I'm on the phone today with, like, you wouldn't believe, but like I was just like on the phone with like Man City and this company and this, and I'm like, oh, I'm plugging this company into this, but it then gives me access to maybe like field side or this, right? Or may give somebody who might need a field side this, right? So I think with relationships and yeah, like no one, I wouldn't have never gotten the opportunity if I didn't have access to like the most exclusive places in Manhattan, right?
Yeah.
And because I have access, now players are then like, oh, like we want access too.
Right.
And then you just show people like, hey, I'm genuinely not here to take advantage of you. I'm genuinely here to just bring you value and, you know, treat you right, you know?
Yeah.
And I think you do that in every walk of life, of any business that you have. You treat people right. You bring value to them. I think, you know, then you could tap in and be like, yo, Darrius, like, I know you said you were speaking to Man City by chance. You could give me an intro to somebody at the marketing department, right?
Yeah.
And that's how it works, you know? So it's always like something where it's full circle. You just keep connecting the dots. You know, if you're going for something real big, you definitely have to be in a space where you have to be able to provide value to your customers, you know?
Just you coming into the studio, it just feels like your wheels are turning. Like even like, I'll tell the podcast that like, you know, the second you came in the studio, you're like, my girl has a podcast. We have something like that. Like everything is kind of about it connecting.
That's my brain never stops.
That's what I mean. Does that ever get exhausting? Is it ever like, man, like.
It did. Cause like in New York, right? So
yeah,
in New York, with the nightlife business,
right?
Like I've worked seven nights a week for 7 years. Right. I've done that before. And then like maybe 5 years at like 6 days.
Yeah.
So I've done that before and it's like always finding the balance. So for me, I would find the balance of in my work day, like I would take time off to go to the gym, switch off my phone, take 2 hours, meditate in space. And I know I'm not pushing towards a goal. Like when I hit that goal, I'm definitely going on vacation. I'm definitely traveling, but like I'm going to like Manchester in 3 weeks, you know, it is for work, but I want to enjoy some of the other things too, you know? So you just find, even if you're not traveling or like you're not, you know, you can't afford to travel, you can't do something, just like, oh, enjoy a nice walk with your headphones on, with a nice podcast, you know, yeah. Eat, Pray, Ball podcast, you know what I mean?
For sure.
It's something like that where you just find the beauty in the now, and it doesn't really get, it gets tiring sometimes.
Yeah.
Like sometimes I'm screaming like, this is a lot. But then I also know it's not a permanent thing and I'm working towards a goal, and I've been to the stage of my life where I've seen amazing results. Mm-hmm. Then you're like, oh, amazing results can happen. Like I've been witnessed it. And if you're younger and you're listening to a podcast and you'd be like, oh, then amazing results are possible when you work hard, you know, right?
Yeah.
So if you haven't experienced it yet, like you can hear it from like a person who's like done amazing, like I've achieved such amazing things sometimes in my life and they were great. I know we move on to new goals, but it was like, you could, if you work hard, you could achieve it. It's not that just like your parents just saying work hard and you could achieve it. It's like you can genuinely like achieve good things by putting your head down and just working and connected.
It's funny you say that. I'm at like a point in my life where I'm starting to kind of recall some of the like cheesy idioms or cliches where it's like, I'm talking about the stuff you would hang on posters in like primary school, which is like, you know, if you believe it, you can achieve it.
Right.
Or, just things like that where you're just like, yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But then you kind of look back and you're like, oh, it really, it was that simple. It wasn't like the process wasn't that simple, but it was like, you know, put your head down and work hard and you'll get it. Or I'm trying to think of like some of the like real simple ones.
I feel like you're on the spot right now, so it's like difficult. But like when you go in the shower, you're like, oh yeah.
Yeah, you know, like everyone. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's just like, and you're just kind of like, man, like, I guess it was just that, like anything you put your mind to, things like that. And that's a lot of what this podcast is like. Just providing like kind of some access for people to understand that we're all people, you know what I mean? And I'm sure like you working in that industry, in the nightlife industry in New York, you're seeing, you know, not just the ballers who are coming in. They're probably like, you know, second tier or even third tier to some of the like, you know,
I've worked with princes, ooh, Saudi princes, like billionaires, and like working with the princess was like insane. we literally looked out and took care of a lot of people who just came into like an intimidating city like New York.
Yeah.
And you just wanted to have a plug.
Yeah.
You know, as we say, like we weren't plugs back then, but that's technically what we were.
Yeah,
right? So we were the plugs, and like being plug, like it then afforded you access to other people's networks and other people's offerings as well, to from a safe space. Like if you were like an asshole, like no one wants to like work with you. But if you're genuinely nice to people and you treat people right, and sometimes, most times, I would say one of my favorite mantras is, you know, help others even if they can't help you.
Mm-hmm.
And I just like leave it out there, and it's just like, if I could help people, if I could, you know, connect you to somebody.
Pay it forward.
It doesn't, right? For me, it just ends there. It's like, oh yeah, it's like a message, a plug, totally fine, you know? Yeah. And I hope everybody could win.
Yes. Yeah.
That's it.
That's exactly what you want. So let's shift into like the real like football, soccer side of things. Yeah, like, you know, I got so many questions. I mean, you go on your Instagram and you see players everywhere. Right. Like, what's the like goal of Ultrain? And maybe that's like too high level now, but is this more about youth development? Is this more about just access? Like, what is the kind of overarching message or goal that you're trying to push?
Yeah, I think for me, Ultrain comes back to a personal experience that happened to me when I was 14.
Yeah.
And I was actually in Trinidad and I was finishing like my secondary school, and I was just doing bad in school. I didn't really care. And the national team captain came in to speak to us. Like, he went to our high school, and I was the first time I ever saw like a pro player. And then, you know, he was playing somewhere in Europe, and it was the first time I saw a pro player. He went to our school. He kind of represented what, you know, like us.
Making it. Yeah.
And he was like, at 14, I remember giving, you know, like I was being a pain in school, not doing work, but I changed at that age. And it was so, so crazy that moment stuck with me, and it stuck with me for my entire life. And it was him not even having, like, I didn't have cell phones then, but him I did have a cell phone. It was the Motorola peanut one back then.
Oh yeah,
it had no internet. Yeah. But yeah. But
different times.
Different times. It had no internet. But it was him saying that in an auditorium, maybe like 40 people really plugged in and connected to me, and I was like, oh, like it always stuck with me that pro players or like people that you look up to could have such an impact and it could change lives. And when you say what the goal of Ultrain is, it's honestly to change lives. And not everybody, you know, like you jumping on a call with, let's just say like maybe Jordan Henderson at Liverpool, right? And he was on a live stream and he might say something that could impact some people's lives and change their lives. And for me, I didn't go on to play at the highest level, but for me, it gave me opportunity where I had like, it pushed me on it genuinely to get, and I got Division I scholarship and I played college ball for free.
Yeah.
I actually got paid to play, and then that offered me the opportunity while going to school in New York, the opportunity to become an entrepreneur, right? Now, if I never had that interaction or I never heard those words or messages, like I could have been, you know, I could have not had the career that I've had, you know, it could have taken a different way. So I realized the impact that connecting with the people that you look up to, like you love football so much, right? And you might not be thinking of going pro, but to hear like one of your favorite people, you know, like, you know, it could be like Carlos Vela, you know, and you know, he has a big fan base, and him telling like, yo, like when I was 13, you know, like no one picked me, but I really believed in myself and I really pushed hard, you know, and you know, it was just me and my mom to help out, and we just push each other. And to hear that story, and then you look at yourself and you're like, wow, I'm like a young boy, a girl, and you listen to that.
Yeah.
It's like, wow, like it could change lives. And for us, that's what we want to do and bring that effect. And unfortunately, it's like, oh, we can't put a pro player in every person's school, but what we can do is make it accessible to everybody.
Yeah.
On our app. And we're launching at the end of May. So people would then have, you know, when you get that invite to join on the beta, on the first rounds of it, you then have the opportunity to sit down, like, you know, after practice in the car and just log on and just be like, oh, okay, cool. Like, this is what, you know, Katie Zella is talking about, you know, and like, and she's like giving advice and like one of the coolest experiences that we've had. So on our first year of working in the company, we had to do an MVP, which is a minimal viable product in the tech world.
Yeah.
I had to learn whole new tech jargon.
Yeah,
I had to take in a lot of books to learn all of these terms, because I had to speak and walk the walk.
Right.
But when we had to create that to then raise, to show like, hey, like this is interest and people are willing to pay for this thing, you know, we did it through a website and we just, you know, we brought like, I remember one session we did with Alessia Russo, who plays for England, and she did the crazy back heel in that Euros.
Yeah,
she did that crazy back heel.
Yeah.
She was like injured and she was like talking to these like 15-year-old girls in San Francisco, and these girls like all, like they had every Saturday they jumped on and they were speaking to players like that. And for some of them, it was like, it was so impactful for them. And they're like just believing in themselves and seeing another woman like doing what they love, but also, you know, not ashamed to own it, you know, and to be a baller, you know. So she was like in sessions going to, we did like, you know, some of her college highlights. She played at UNC and she was going crackers, and she was like, this is what I did, you know, and this is what I eat before games and stuff like that. So I think like creating those experiences, then people were like, oh, like investors were like, oh, people actually want to pay for that. And that's all we got to raise by creating that minimal viable product, where it's like a website, people went on Zoom, that was it.
Wow.
And then from there, then that's where you go to the next level to raise funding.
Yeah.
But yeah, like that experience, like we saw girls' lives, like we saw them like
light up.
Yeah. And it was just over the screen, you know? Yeah. But it meant a lot.
Yeah. No, it doesn't mean a lot. I'm trying to think, like, there's such a business part of this, which is just like We have to create
how to raise.
Yeah, how, like, how do you even like raise money? How, who do we even like? What's the first call you make, right?
Yeah.
Or even to get to that website to create this like Zoom environment to just create an MVP. That's a new buzzword too. I'm holding on to that.
Yeah. Listen, everywhere. I don't read physical books, but listen to audiobook. A lean startup for any business that you want to do. It doesn't have to be an app. It could be anything. A lean startup. Mm. Teaches you how to be, how to change your mindset on starting a business. Because, you know, the first thing that, like, I jumped into immediately was like, I want to start an app.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, no.
Which is what everybody says, right?
Yeah. Like, I want to do an app. And it's like, no, and do not do an app first.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Do you know any developers?
Create something that, like, you have to test to see if people like it.
Yeah.
Not if you like it. And create something that can make an impact. Mm-hmm. You know? And I think, if you do something that makes an impact and could change people's lives, then you might have something that could be successful one day.
Yeah. Do you have any, you're basically the connecting glue. Like I understand how your connections to players and clubs and whatnot, but then how on the opposite side, how are you, what's you know, your access to the kids and the youth who are looking for this, or the parents?
Yeah. So we work really hard, like, following that model of a lean startup being lean. So a lean startup could be like, you could start a company for less than $1,000, but you could get form an LLC,
right?
Get a website, you know, get a basic product going and just working off of that and being so lean. Like, I think working with the players, like, I think if you show everyone in the chain of the product value.
Yeah.
Like, hey, players, like, you could impact people's lives. Hey, kids, you could do this. Hey, parents, like, your kids might need this, right? We realized that we had to work really hard on the ecosystem of soccer parents and coaches.
Yeah.
So a lot of our time was spent not on the pro side, but on the parents and coaches side, which we found by trial and error.
Yeah.
To be fair, to be honest with you, it wasn't like an immediate success.
Yeah.
We tried stuff and it failed. Like, we tried to work to like say, hey kids, like, here's a cool product that could help you. Mm-hmm. But for kids, you know, more likely than not, they can't afford a product.
Right.
And then they might not know what's best for them. You know, they might know what's trendy, but not what's best for them. So we had to learn the long way, but I think building your community is one of the biggest lessons I learned before you do any business. Build a community.
Yeah, super important stuff.
Yeah.
So your community is LA based to a certain extent. I mean, obviously it's international, but the roots are here.
Now. Yeah, I think in terms of coaches and clubs and stuff like that, it's, you know, across the country. We have a lot of fans in California.
Yeah.
And most of our fans are in California, like, kids wise.
Yeah.
Pro player wise, I would say like MLS, NWSL. It varies across the leagues.
Yeah.
But that's really our ecosystem there, you know?
Yeah. Are these like clubs that are associated with each other? Like, I know there's some clubs that kind of, maybe they're like franchises in a way, but go across the country. I know I was just talking to a coach / trainer a couple of weeks ago where the New York Red Bulls kind of have a team of coaches that they train, and even if they go on somewhere else, there's still that network there, obviously.
Oh, okay. Just working, like, we did hundreds of meetings with coaches.
Yeah, okay, so just straight grassroots.
We went on. We got a lot of rejections, you know, coaches like, oh, I have no time, we just worked really hard on building our community first, and it's something that didn't really, like, I knew it, when I look back on my career in the event space and, like, what we built and, like, the name that we made in New York, it was all based off, like, people cared about us, and, like, we had our own community, but I just didn't call it that, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I didn't call it that.
I just, like, oh, I know so-and-so.
But that is your community.
That's your community.
You know?
And
I think, like, that's, like, a definite, like, big learning lesson for me was just starting any business. Just think about, like, how you can build a community first.
Yeah.
Whether it be a podcast, whether it be a newsletter, you know, like you have a community, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Your listeners are your community and they trust you, you know?
Yeah.
And they stick around to hear you because they know that you're going to bring good people, genuine people on board. They trust you. You sound genuine. You're a good guy, you know? So like your community trusts you, you know? And it's cool to like, it's cool to have that, you know? And,
yeah.
And that's yours.
Yeah. A lot of my community building is literally just around kind of the love of the game.
Right.
You know, and I noticed that I could go anywhere around the world, you know, and talk to a cab driver, talk to a bartender, talk to whoever, and almost the easiest way to almost develop a relationship is to tell them, hey, like, I support these teams, I watch this, oh, you're this, you know, supporter,
yeah.
Y'all didn't do well in the World Cup, whatever it is, and then it kind of builds.
Yeah.
One, what was your team growing up, and have you stuck with them? And two, like, was any of that kind of helping build your relationships with players? Like, just talk, like, just the banter and
yeah.
Shit talk about it?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think, like, being in that New York events, you know, the nightclub space, I met people from across the world. So I was able to pick up things from yeah. different cities, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it be a slang, whether it be, you know, like you're Swedish, you like, you learn a little slang,
yeah.
you know, German, you learn something, you learn about like what each city does. So someone says, let's just say like Berlin, like, you know, like, oh, what they eat there or something mm-hmm. like that, right? So you always could pick something up
yeah.
to do that, right?
Yeah.
And in terms of, like, my team growing up, somehow I just grew up, like, in Italy, so I always watched, like, Italian football.
Interesting.
And I was, yeah, I remember that, like, watching them in the World Cup finals. And, like, as a kid, I was really small, and I didn't remember much, but I just remember, like, Baggio and those guys, mm-hmm. and then like what, like grew up like in Del Piero,
yeah,
and Maldini and those guys. So I was always, and I turned into a defender. So
defense.
I'm like,
that's how I was supposed to say, defense mind. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. like for my mind, it was always that, you know. So I think like I always grew up like that, and then like Juventus was like the thing back then.
For sure.
But now it's a situation where like I have friends who play in different teams
yeah,
and leagues.
True, yeah.
So if I go to like a game, I'm just. It's weird, like, I just root for good football. No.
Wow.
Yeah. No,
interesting.
It's weird, like, I go to a game or, like, I watch Premier League on the weekend, I'm like, and I see somebody I know and I want them to do well,
mm-hmm.
but then I'm like, all right, well, I want, you know, City to play good football or Man United to do this.
Yeah.
So it's, when people ask me, like, I hate when I get, because then I'll have to be like that guy who, like, I don't have a team.
I
want to have a team.
Yeah, I usually talk shit to people on this podcast, you know, like, you don't have a team.
Yeah, no, I'm the guy who doesn't have a team. So I'm always like, when I hear people asking around, I'm like, kind of like putting my hoodie on, you know? But,
yeah,
you
know, I'm just here for good ball.
Yeah, I'm just here. I just like football. I'm a fan of the game,
yeah.
you know? So,
yeah.
So that's what being in the business, it kind of makes you a product of that.
For sure.
And I see football and I think about the game and I think about like owning clubs and I think about marketing like in a different way
yeah.
that I look at a franchise so differently than I did when I wasn't in like this space
yeah.
now.
Yeah, I'm starting to see these different franchises and businesses differently.
Yeah.
It's funny being in the space where I'm really trying to understand like MLS and how it's owned and operated versus, I guess, the rest of the world, which
yeah.
is which we're told is the better way.
Right.
You know, it's obviously from a development standpoint, it's better.
Yeah.
But in terms of a business, like I look at LAFC, which is now my new favorite team.
So, right.
You know,
yeah, I love because, LAFC.
Yeah, they're just fun. They're right, the neighborhood team. Yeah. A lot of supporters.
15-minute drive and you're
15-minute drive and you're there. Right. Like I love that aspect. But them, unlike other MLS teams, bring in a lot of international players,
right.
don't necessarily have a fully, I guess, developed infrastructure around their youth development and stuff like that. So I'm trying to kind of understand, I guess, when I hear you say, like, from a business standpoint, what makes these teams, like, what makes a city outside of just the money now one of the biggest clubs worldwide, right, where they have almost, you know, now they have NYCFC connections.
Right.
They have connections to, I think, a couple
City has a couple
connections. City has a couple of like the umbrella for.
And then Red Bull has like four.
Red Bull's got
four or five. I think they're one in Brazil now too. Oh, I think they're one in Brazil now too.
Crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you connected to any of them?
No, I'm not. But like from the outside standpoint of the game of sport, right? So I tell people like I think like for the owner of a club, they love to see like the narratives of sports, right? So they love to see like a rivalry between Manchester United and Arsenal, right? Like that builds up hype every single time, you know?
Yeah.
And a lot of, you know, UK people like hate on the Americans coming in, but traditionally, like and sticking with tradition, it doesn't help the thing grow because the user changes and what their experiences and their senses change, right? Mm. Like our senses back in like the 90s of watching a TV on like our like no HD, no anything has completely changed the sound system it is now. So like things are always changing and you know, the European way is like, let's keep things the same. No this, no Super League, no anything. But you know, when you look at the studies, you're gonna see like the viewership dropping and kids watching just the highlights, right? Because they want the action packet. There are so much attention on different things now. Sports is for two things, entertainment and to make money.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people confuse like heart with it and teams with heart, but that's what owners want, right? Owners want you to have heart for your team and stand in the rain because like you're paying a ticket price to do it. But I always say, and this is no like shade on like European game, but I watched this documentary. I was flying back from England to LA, and there was one documentary showing like the history of the Premier League on the plane, right? Mm-hmm. And it was a guy who was working in the NFL in the 90s. And he started the Premier League back then, and they were like, "No, you can't cut it down to 20 teams." It was like 40 teams was not what it is. You can't that you'll kill the game, and then look at the product. And he was like, he did cheerleading on halftime, and he tried to bring a lot of different things there to spice the game up because it was just known for fighting and everything like that. And families would then being able to start coming. And what we see, I think, when I tell a lot of my friends is like, if you look at like the biggest thing, what in America, we understand is marketing and branding. Mm. And when you look at the Dallas Cowboys, they probably have 5% of Barcelona's fans and they make more money than Barcelona.
Wow.
Like they probably have like 5% of the fan base Barcelona has. Yeah. And they make like 10 times the money that Barcelona has because like they sell a family package. They sell you like buy this Dak Prescott jersey, buy this mug, buy this, you know? Whereas like I feel like in the European way, like they sell you like, oh, like have heart, have this.
Yeah, then, love us.
But come. Like you might get one jersey, but you might not buy like a true Cowboys fan has like a plethora of stuff.
Every year they have
every year, right? Yeah, whereas you think about how many football jerseys you truly have.
Yeah.
And it's kinda indicative. Like that's why Man United is probably like the boost, like top is because I'm not saying just because of Americans, but like I went on their like tour and I was like, I left there and I was like, wow, I want to buy something.
Yeah.
And it takes you into the fan shop, right?
Yeah.
When you're done the tour, it's like, wow, it feels like an American experience. And I guess that's what they bring. But I feel like just kind of going back to it, I feel like the difference is like Americans understand the marketing side of how to upsell a product or like put on a show. Mm-hmm. That's why the NFL always just changes the rules. Mm-hmm. Like they want more points. Whereas in soccer, like in Europe, they're like so afraid to like, oh, no running in subs and stuff like that. But imagine like coming to see, I was giving the example, like Cristiano coming off and then coming back on 75 minutes.
Yeah.
It's 1-1 and he's fresh. Like, what would that do? You know, like maybe it might have, you know, a lot more older players who could come in, Thiago could come in and come out, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm not saying I want the rules to change. Any British people on here, I'm not saying that. But
what is he talking about?
But that's just like how my mind works on the sport now. Yeah. And like of seeing like hey, like when, you know, some clubs in UK approach me, you know, they're like, how do we tap into the American market? Mm. No, they're like, oh, we're market out. Like we have all like they have like you can't really buy a ticket to go to a United game. It's 38 games. But in the NFL, you could buy a ticket off a StubHub.
Right.
Yeah, you pay a premium price, you buy a ticket. But in UK, it's so hard to go to. Like, you can't go online and look for Man United.
You got
to
join the club.
Exactly.
Join the
exactly.
user list, all that. Yeah.
So not seeing that they're shade on it, but, like, when I look at sports now, I'm thinking, like, oh, like, this is a huge business. Like, you make money from... I was talking to a coach and he was like, you can make money from buying into like an Irish team and they going into Europa League, right? Mm-hmm. And it's like few teams and you and your club will make money from that, right?
Yeah.
And it's just like seeing sports on a different lens of being an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
I sat back and I watched and I'm like, oh, like I see what they're doing. I see why like people complain like Chelsea spent a ton of money, but like a player, one of his players on the Dodgers has like a $500 million contract, right?
Absolutely.
You know, so like if the big, I don't know the bigger picture. I don't know if the bigger picture is still like, you know, you selling jerseys or like they want to be in Europe or whatever it is, mm-hmm. but there it might be a bigger picture there. And I think with the MLS, I think we're not far away from, you know, creating a cool product that may not necessarily like what we don't like they stop bringing in like older players,
right?
But you're making a cool product when you go to an LAFC game. Totally. It's a, you get your money's worth.
Yeah
You get your money's worth when you go to like, you know, like a Vancouver Whitecaps game, like
Seattle. Even,
yeah you get your money's worth. Like I'm sure Atlanta's probably lit.
I'm sure.
I saw it there.
I'm from Atlanta. My mom sent me this years ago when the expansion team started, but they were like filling up the football stadium,
right?
You know, the 100,000 seater Georgia Dome. So yeah, I can imagine they have a product. And it's funny you say that, because that product would probably stretch across the world faster if there wasn't a mentality that soccer in America was like lower tier. You
exactly.
know what I mean? And man, you have my mind racing now, because I had a conversation with a friend the other day. We were talking about the World Cup teams or the cities that the 2026 World Cup will host. And which city will ultimately be picked for the final.
Right.
And I think I read an article and New York and LA were my, like, I'm sure the final will be somewhere there. But I think the top candidates were like Chicago, maybe San Francisco, and Texas, and the Dallas Stadium in Texas. So you mentioning that is funny, because my friend was like, yeah, I mean, knowing how Jerry Jones and those guys do it down there, they politic, they lobby for these things,
right.
And then they try to create like a, like, this is Texas. This is what you get. This is Texas football, right? Vibe. I feel like they would probably be the best to host the final. Ooh. Also being close across the border to Mexico, who's also hosting some games.
Don't say that, so, man. I was hoping LA.
I was hoping LA too, you know? Yeah, but I'm not.
I feel like we could possibly do it with the weather, but I don't know if we're like that proactive to... Like, there's so much going on in LA.
Yeah.
Like, we don't necessarily
need it. It's coming here anyway, right?
Yeah. Games, we don't necessarily need it, but we do have, like, a huge football stadium.
Huge.
That we can play in.
Multiple.
Yeah.
I mean, the best one would be the brand new one, SoFi Stadium.
Yeah, SoFi would be, like, the spot, but I would say out of every city in America, LA probably would have the best weather climate, because New York is really hot.
Yeah.
And New York is not really New York. So you're not getting New York when you do New York.
Right.
It's New Jersey.
You're in New Jersey. Yeah.
And there's nothing going on that side of things. Like I grew up a Giants fan, so I've always taken the train.
Take the train of MetLife, and then, you know, you're
so
going
there's nothing going on there. But yeah, I think like, yeah, if you said Dallas, then oh man.
Yeah.
I will go.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm gonna go, but yeah.
I have to go. But yeah, no, I agree. I wish it was in LA. I feel like there would be more. I don't know. LA feels packed, but it's so spread out that it would be easier for people to travel.
Yeah, we can host events. We can definitely do the events.
Yeah, we need to pop. Maybe we should be lobbying. Like, yo, come through. Eat, pray, ball. We'll set up tents, whatever. We'll have Ultrain Sports out here. Come to LA. That'll be with the final. Yeah, we'll have that soon. But
I hope so.
I hope so too. But it is an interesting thought process.
Not too far away. Not too far away.
It's not. It's almost here. Yeah. You know, we've got Women's World Cup this year, and then the Euros. In a year, I guess, and then the World Cup comes in 2026.
Wow.
Yeah, it's gonna be
qualifiers.
We have all this stuff coming up, and again, we have more and more young American players going over to Europe playing. Like, this is the time, you know, this is definitely the time.
You just need to bring it together.
Yes.
Bring the chemistry together.
That's the point. Just bring it all together. Yeah. Were you supporting anybody specifically? Italy was out of the World Cup.
Yeah, Italy was out. So I guess USA.
Yeah, you're
all supported in USA, like 100%. Yeah, they played ball.
Yeah.
And I love like the young guys. I love like Aronson and those guys.
Yeah.
You know? So
yeah,
I think if there's some team chemistry, you know, we could definitely make some noise. And like if US football, I feel like we were touching on that, but I feel like what we would love to bring, and this is like kind of taps into our. The umbrella company we launched this year under Ultrain is founding coaches, which we're doing an event in Miami, and we're bringing, how can I drop the name? We're bringing John Terry. we're bringing like
exclusive.
Yeah, we're bringing some big names in June, June 15th, 16th, 17th, and we want to. I think I think what's missing from the American game isn't like we have the best facilities like youth level going down. I was at UCLA with Anthony Gordon and Curtis Jones, and they were like, wow, this is better than like so many like Premier League
facilities.
Like that was better. Like Everton's old as hell. Like it's so bad, like rusty.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like we have facilities, we have doctors, we have trainers, we have nutritionists. I think the thing that we miss in America is when you're like 15 years old, you're gonna be coached, and this is no shade on anyone, but you're probably gonna be coached by somebody who's played like high school ball most.
D2.
Maybe if you're lucky, play college.
Yeah.
But you're gonna be coached by someone like that. Whereas if you're playing ball in Liverpool and you're decent, like you're gonna be coached by somebody who's probably played in the Premier League, who's played at the highest level, who might have played national team.
Yeah.
And in America, like how many kids are being coached by people with that type of experience? Not saying that it is a make or break, but it shows like we have way more kids playing youth soccer than in England than any other country. Like boys and girls, just compared to combined. And you know, we have the talent, we have athleticism. I would say we're more athletic than them. Like I don't see any English people dunking like LeBron James, right?
No, absolutely.
Right, so we have, and catching wide receivers, I don't see that.
At the Olympics, even.
Right? Mm-hmm. So I think that finished product at that age of like 13 to 16, which is like really pivotal, is that like experience of like, this is how you become a pro. And that's what we want to bring. So with Ultrain, you know, like we want to connect kids to that, but we also want to connect coaches. Mm-hmm. So we want to connect coaches to the top tier people who played at the highest level. So like on the app, we're going to have a feature for coaches where they can talk to like higher level people.
Yeah.
And then we're doing live events, you know, twice a year in Miami. And like this first one, June 15, 16, 17, you know, we're going to bring like John's like we win EPL, he's playing Champions League, like he's experienced stuff where he's like, this is the ideal situation, be on stage and be like, all right, well, you were down Barcelona, like what happened in that game? What did Mourinho say?
Yeah.
Like what as a player and as a coach affects you? Like I think those are the things that like we miss at that young age that they get in other academies, at like Man City Academy, at like Southampton Academy, like they get in those things. I think that's just the little edge.
Yeah.
But I think once we get more and more people like, all right, let's just say D1, you play D1, cool. And now you played like maybe international football. I know you're coaching at like the grassroots level. And like, again, yeah, you could follow the tactics and the handbooks, but it's something different when you've played in a locker room in a big game scenario. Mm. And you could then talk to your players in a certain way. I think this is where I think makes the difference in the level of football at that age. As I feel like that age, like we're more athletic, you know.
And
we have people in Cali playing so many times a year, you know. So we have training, we have athleticism. I just feel like with our, and you could go on to foundingcoaches.org, you know, you could see like, you know, just basically what we're doing there and just like where the events are. But, you know, we're doing like intimate events, you know, 500 coaches at an event, you know, bringing, you know, EPL players into the event, and just allowing coaches, from any grassroots level and just fans as well. So it's just not coaches. So definitely want you to come down.
Yeah.
But we, you know, we're teaching people, like, you know, coaches how to form a business LLC, like how to write off taxes if you're in this industry, not just for coaches, but you might be in the soccer space and you want to be like, what's a write off? And how could I write things off? Like, so we bring in people for that, you know, talking about like this leadership mindset on games. And then for me, like, critical part on day two is just like in game scenarios, and I want to replay stuff on the big screen. And I want to, that's where I want to get to. So it's no, like, you know, like, do this drill. Like, none of that. I think you could find those things.
Yeah, you can everywhere. Find trainers. There's great trainers.
YouTube, yeah. Trainers are amazing across the country and everything.
Yeah.
But I wanted to bring the aspect of, yo, these are the top tier people with the top minds and top experiences.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like if you flipped it to, like, you know, you're going to court and you wanted somebody to defend you, and in like a situation where you're in jail for life, right. Like, you would want the person with the most experience. You want the person who's been in, like, the highest experience.
Yeah.
Versus, like, yeah, like, you could get somebody who is, like, new and just learn the handbook.
Yeah.
But you want the highest experience, and that's what founding coaches is. Mm-hmm. So that's what we're doing in Miami. This is the first one we're doing.
It's inaugural.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's really invites us really in our network of our coaches. Or, like, we have agents coming out telling you the behind the scenes of the deal that they've done.
Yeah.
One of my friends, like, you know, he's an agent for, like, a couple of Premier League players. He's coming down and just talking about so many deals and stuff like that. It's going to be super cool to see.
Yeah.
Some people might want to become an agent. Some people might want to switch what they're doing. So we're bringing a lot of that down. So that's going to be really exciting. And that's what we've been working really hard. These, like, it's 3 months out and we're really, like, working hard on curating this event, so it's really good.
It's the top event. Right? Yeah. And so it's right now, it's obviously it's your pilot event, right? So it's smaller, but are you expecting, you said 500 people, 500 coaches, well, players?
Yeah. So we want, like, about 500 coaches and then open it. The room could hold, like, we could hold, like, 1,000, 1,200, yeah. But we want it to be like an intimate experience where you get to actually meet John Terry or ask a question, stuff like that.
Yeah.
We want that experience. You know, and, like, our early birds are, like, relatively cheap for this. It's, like, $199, you know, like, you could get access. And then on the third day, where it's a little bit more exclusive, it's we're having a gala. And this is what we want to curate as the number one event. So combining our New York experience.
I was about to say, this is football. Mr. Event right here.
Yeah, no. So we're creating a gala where, you know, it's a red carpet event. And we're going to bring, like, I already invited, like, a lot of teams. And, you know, we're mailing, like, invites to people in the Premier League and Europe to just come. Everyone's going to be off. So to come to this gala, you know, proceeds will be going to charity. And doing it where we have agents, we have directors, we have just, like, people in music, everyone, like, in one spot, a cool live performance. So it should be really, really fun in Miami. And the first 2 days will just be, like, us learning, but I think the third day would be, like, networking.
Fun
and
just depressing. Yeah. Networking. Yeah. Oh my God.
So
I mean, clearly you know how to throw an event.
Wow. So, well, you know, see if I could dust off the boots and do this one again.
Yeah, show this one again. I think that's super dope. I mean, I talk about how to build the culture in America a lot on this podcast, and I mean, this just seems like a almost a no-brainer, like, it's not just having Americans be exposed to the sport and just love the sport, but it's just kind of bringing the culture around. I think from a European perspective, they look at Americans, like you said, the marketing aspect, and everybody wants to come and be in America, be in Miami, you know, hang out, do
exactly,
cool stuff, right?
Exactly.
Right? So when I think about it, I'm like, what is the draw for all of these people to come over here? And it's like, well, actually, that's the easy part. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Crazy enough, it is. Like, once we hit the brands up, you know, the brands are like, all right, we have these people coming, but they're also too, like, in a weird way, and most of these players who play at, like, in the EPL level, and they're more famous than NBA players, and they have less brand deals.
Yes. You know? Yes. Is that just because the NBA players are in America thing, or?
Well, their culture in the UK, when I spoke to agents, the agents don't really care. Like, they don't, they settle with, like, oh, we got them to sign a contract, maybe a boot deal. Good. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Whereas here, we're like, oh, more brands, more eyes, more
exposure. Bubblicious, icy.
Yeah,
eye,
yeah, know? Exactly. Like, you're, like a Shaq, right?
Yeah, like Shaq. Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. When I think about it, only like Cristiano, maybe Neymar, some others. But
yeah.
Like, Cristiano's the only one who seems like they were yeah, like he was hotels, like, underwear, shoes, toothpaste.
Oil company. He's like, he does like oil companies too.
What? Yeah, okay. Very American yeah. eyes, but.
So yeah, I want to bring value to those players
yeah.
By exposing them to the American market. And well, I know some of them, they, hopefully they trust us to do a good event.
Yeah, for sure.
But founding coaches, the gala on the third day of this is gonna be like, I want it to be the best soccer event in America.
Yeah, whoa. This is the this is what we're reaching for.
Yeah, the best soccer event in America, because when you leave there, we don't want you to leave like just like, oh, like, you know, we had a good time dancing, but it was more like I was able to, as a player, I was able to meet a brand.
Yeah.
I was able to get some advice from an agent. Mm. I was able to, yeah, like as a brand, I want to be able to like connect with like America. Some brands here might not be have the access to connect to those guys, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I had meetings with these brands, and they're like, oh yeah, I would love that. And you know, for a brand to like leave having access to now players and stuff like that, like for us, that's rewarding, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think that's why I want it to be the best, not because of like, we have like amazing person performing, but more so like, nah, I want people to leave with value. Oh, like, I met this person at Founding Coaches, like the gala was amazing, and we got to network and da 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 da, and then we formed, and then we did this deal, and now we shot, and now he's owning this company, and just like the whirlwind of that, you know, I think, again, ecosystem.
Yes.
And always curate your own ecosystem.
Yeah, that's, I mean, honestly, I search for titles of the podcast within the podcast, and that's it. Create your own ecosystem. That's it. Darrius Marcellin here, Ultrain Sports. You got to check it out. Also, what, founding coaches.org.
Yeah.
Fathers. Foundingcoaches.org. Definitely check it out. Listen, if you're listening right now, if you're on Spotify, hit that subscribe button, Apple Music, YouTube, whatever. Check us out. We're bringing more interesting people on like Darrius here to just give us an understanding of the not just the sport in America, but the business around it. It's the EPB Podcast, and we will see you guys later.